Harper Audio presents Leading Ladies, American Trailblazers, written and read by Kay Bailey Hutchison. Copyright 2007 by Kay Bailey Hutchison. Production copyright 2007 by HarperCollins Publishers. My goal in Leading Ladies is to inspire young women and men with the stories of women who have found their own path rather than following a conventional road. But it isn't just young people who can benefit from role models. I think we all go through periods in our lives when we're in transition and our focus isn't clear. At these times, I find it best to step back and try to rejuvenate my spirit by rethinking and defining my goals. Hearing the stories of people whose courage, brilliance, creativity, or perseverance has made a positive contribution to the world is one of the ways to get new ideas that might lead to a new direction. Someday, I hope to read an interview with a woman who has just landed on Mars or discovered a cure for cancer. And she says she was encouraged to pursue her goals by a book she read about an early pioneer who broke barriers to rise to the top of the military, be elected to Congress, or win the Nobel Prize. I've always believed that the United States is the greatest country on earth because women have become full participants in our society. When 100% of a nation's brain power is put to work, the result is exponentially improved. But in every field, the opportunity has been won, not given. I could only tell the stories of a few of the incredible women who have contributed to the strength and progress of our nation. It is my firm belief that without the participation of women throughout our society, the United States would not be the world's greatest superpower. And the best is yet to come. Fighting the Good Fight. Women in the military. In my time in the Senate, I have seen the role women play in the military transformed from limited support to full-fledged participation. Women throughout our history have shown great bravery as spies for the American cause, as volunteers in hospitals, as ferry pilots, but full recognition has been slow to arrive. Women received general officer status for the first time in 1970, and there are still no women with 4 stars, the highest peacetime rank. Several of our top military leaders have daughters who have attended the prestigious military academies. Once, while listening to a 4-star general's briefing about women's roles in military conflict, I said to him, "I just want your daughter to be able to have enough experience to succeed you." In other words, if we expect to attract the best women to military careers, they must know they have a chance of reaching the top. To do that, women must have enough time in combat zones to allow them to earn the credibility essential to lead a branch of the armed services. There have been many issues to address, and we are addressing them. There were early concerns about fraternization between the sexes and about sexual harassment. There have been problems in this area, but there is zero tolerance for misconduct, and I believe the professionalism in our military is second to none in the world. Women have proven themselves in our elite service academies and are gaining combat experience, flying fighter and carrier airplanes in war zones, and participating in many ground missions as well. This has been the traditional route to the top for men, and women are now in the pipeline. Though this is relatively new for the armed services, American women on the front lines in war is not. In the Revolutionary War, our first war for freedom, women participated when they could, sometimes even disguising themselves as men in order to join the battle. Women played relatively small roles in the War of 1812 and the Mexican-American War, but the American Civil War was another story. Its toll of 600,000 dead on both sides makes it by far the costliest war in human terms in American history. As a result, The constant demand for new soldiers ensured that virtually anyone, male or female, who was determined to enlist could manage to elude the barriers of age, size, fitness, or sex that were intended to screen out unsuitable recruits. In the words of one scholar, if a candidate was tall enough, wasn't lame, deaf, or blind, had enough teeth to open powder cartridges and a trigger finger with which to shoot, he or she was usually accepted. Historians today agree that the number of women who wore the uniforms of the Union or Confederacy at some time during the 4-year-long conflict was probably close to 1,000, and the total may well have been higher. As happened during the American Revolution, a few women went to war alongside their husbands without masquerading as men. Others pretended to be the brothers or comrades of their spouses and fiancés. One newlywed, Hattie Martin of Pennsylvania, donned men's clothing when she and her new husband enlisted, but revealed her identity to the examining physician, who let the couple join up. As often as not, women who enlisted with their husbands stayed at the front even after their men had been killed. When Amy Clark's husband was mortally wounded at Shiloh, she stayed with her company until she herself was wounded and captured by Union troops. They sent her home, wearing a dress, after she had recovered. Some recruiting officers may have winked at the rules out of friendship with, or sympathy for, the protagonists, but that usually wasn't necessary. The women simply donned loose-fitting men's clothing, mimicked, as best they could, masculine hairstyles and mannerisms, and relied on the casualness of the physical exams to do the rest, just as sickly and underage enlistees did. Too little is known about the women, North or South, who went to war or dreamed of doing so, to speculate how many acted out of patriotism, how many were seeking adventure, and how many saw a chance for independence and economic opportunity that was accessible to most men, but very few women. Even women who accepted their traditional role as ladies sometimes chafed at the restrictions. Lucy Breckenridge confided in her journal, "I would gladly shoulder my pistol and shoot some Yankees if it were allowable." And there were others, like the 20 women in the Shenandoah Valley who wrote to Judah Benjamin, the Confederate Secretary of War. They proposed to form a volunteer regiment of women for local defense because all the men in the vicinity, between the ages of 16 and 60, had been drafted. They gave up the idea, though, after Mr. Benjamin declined their offer. Sarah Emma Edmonds. We do know a great deal about the thinking of one soldier girl, as women in the military were popularly known, whether passing as men or not. Sarah Emma Edmonds joined the 2nd Michigan Cavalry in 1861 under the alias Frank Thompson. She served until 1863. Probably the best-known woman soldier in the Civil War, Sarah was born in New Brunswick, Canada in 1841. At the age of 17, she left home disguised as a young man and found work in the United States as a traveling book salesman for a Hartford, Connecticut company. She may have left Canada to escape from a tyrannical father or to avoid being pressured into marriage. She adopted her alias and male disguise because she assumed it would be easier to live independently if people believed she was a man. When the Civil War started, Sarah was living in Michigan. Less than 6 weeks later, she enlisted as Private Frank Thompson. An entry in her diary written during the early days of the war gives voice to her feelings. "It is true I am not an American, not obliged to remain here during the terrible strife, but it is not my desire to seek personal ease and comfort while so much sorrow and distress fills the land." Attached to a cavalry regiment, Sarah, nevertheless, started her army career as an infantryman assigned to drill, picket, and guard duty. During the Battle of Fredericksburg, she was General Orlando Poe's orderly and then for 6 months a nurse in the regimental hospital, a general hospital in Georgetown, where she distinguished herself by the care, kindness, and self-sacrificing devotion she showed to patients. After the disastrous Union defeat in the First Battle of Bull Run on July 21, 1861, Sarah also served as a field nurse. "I had inherited from my mother a rare gift of nursing," she later wrote. In 1861 and 62, she also carried the mail and troop orders. It was while working as a courier that she contracted malaria, but she enjoyed the freedom the work offered so much that she continued doing it despite the danger to her health. The risk of discovery was greatest for women soldiers who required medical attention after being wounded or falling ill. A woman whose identity was discovered was almost always dismissed from service, so women often tried to conceal their conditions and refused medical help. Sarah suffered injuries 3 times, once in battle, but managed to avoid the doctors each time. In August 1862, while she was carrying mail between Manassas and Washington, she was thrown from her mule and suffered contusions to her leg and a lung hemorrhage. She coughed blood for a week and was lame for longer, but managed to camouflage the severity of her injuries. Another time, during a battle, the horse she was riding was shot, and Sarah broke a bone when she fell. When the symptoms of her malaria returned in March 1863, Sarah refused, as usual, to go to the hospital, but this time she was afraid that if her condition worsened, she would be found out. So she applied for a leave of absence. It was denied, and she deserted near Lebanon, Kentucky, rather than risk discovery. She wrote, "I never for a moment considered myself a deserter. I simply left because I could hold out no longer, and to become a helpless patient in a hospital was sure discovery, which to me was far worse than death." More than 30 years later, when Sarah, suffering from arthritis, requested supplementary benefits, the Pension Bureau refused on the grounds that the Army had no medical record of her ever having been sick or injured during the war. In her rebuttal, Sarah struck the same note again. "Had I been what I represented myself to be, I should have gone to the hospital. But being a woman, I felt compelled to suffer in silence in order to escape detection of my sex. I would rather have been shot dead than to have been known to be a woman and sent away from the Army." From the scarce writings available, it appears that male comrades of women who masqueraded as men usually liked and even admired the women with whom they served. This was true of single women, as well as those who accompanied their husbands. Even pregnant women, who sometimes succeeded in carrying their pregnancies to term without being detected, were described with affection. After one woman had given birth, another soldier described her as a young and good-looking corporal whose courtesy and military bearing struck the officers very favorably and who was a real soldierly, thoroughly military fellow. Sarah Edmonds was no exception. The other soldiers liked her, and even those who knew or suspected her secret steadfastly kept it to themselves. She did take Jerome John Robbins into her confidence. He was an assistant surgeon in the 2nd Michigan Infantry, whom Sarah befriended at the regimental hospital in Alexandria, Virginia, where she was a nurse. The otherwise circumspect Sarah's reasons for revealing to Robbins that she was a woman just 2 weeks or so after they met aren't clear. She may have taken a romantic interest in him, and her revelation strained their friendship for a time. Dr. Robbins apparently discouraged her interest. He insisted that he had a girlfriend back in Michigan, but he told no one about Sarah's identity. He recorded the fact in his diary on November 16, 1861, and then sealed the pages. He marked them with these words: "Please allow these leaves to be closed until the author's permission is given for their opening." Interestingly, Sarah did not tell Dr. Robbins what her real name was. If romance was the reason for the temporary rift in Sarah's friendship with him, the attachment probably wasn't her only military infatuation. Researchers have unearthed the diaries of two members of the 2nd Michigan Regiment in which the soldiers hint that the cause of Sarah's decision to desert in April 1863 may not have been malaria. In fact, it could have been a broken heart. Sarah's later testimony disputes that suggestion, but we will never be sure. These diaries confirm that at least two soldiers in the 2nd Michigan knew or strongly suspected that Frank Thompson was a woman, but they didn't consider betraying her either. After recuperating from her battle with malaria, Sarah surfaced again in Oberlin, Ohio, this time without her disguise. She served as a nurse under the auspices of the U.S. Sanitary Commission, the civilian corps of nurses headed by healthcare reformer Dorothea Dix. In 1864, with the war still raging, she published a somewhat fictionalized memoir of her wartime experiences. The original sensational title was Unsexed, or The Female Soldier. However, it was rechristened the next year as Memoirs of a Soldier, Nurse, and Spy, a more demure title. The book, published by W.S.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.